Welcome to Tracing Your Family Roots. This is Sally Ann Sack, and we're pleased to welcome Matthew Kaplan.
And you are?
I'm Arlene Sack. I didn't...
Too early in the morning.
After 200 shows, people have to know me.
Okay.
Matthew Kaplan, and he is the project lead for the Human Origins Genotyping Laboratory. Did I get all of that right?
You did, and it is quite a mouthful.
Please tell us what at the
University of Arizona, yes. My laboratory, the Human Origins Genotyping Laboratory, we are a service corps at the University of Arizona. We're part of Arizona Research Laboratories. We are in the Division of Biotechnology. And that's sort of what we do. We do biotechnology, and we do big biotech projects. And so what brings me here with you today is that we're involved with a number of projects that relate to human ancestry, human genealogy, and such. And, I mean, from my perspective, I see it all as one grand continuum at this point.
More than one project?
Oh,
What are some of the projects that are related to
Well,
this?
Our newest and one of the ones that I'm excited about all of them, but is the DNA Shoah Project. The DNA Shoah Project is a humanitarian effort that we're doing to reconnect families separated by the Holocaust, trying to stitch together what the Nazis tore apart. And some of the projects that your audience may be more familiar with,
such as
in the greater DC area, is we do the public participant testing for National Geographic and IBM's Genographic Project. We also, as your group, I understand, is genealogical in interest, we also do the public or the high-throughput testing projects for family tree DNA.
High-throughput?
Yes, high-throughput is if you're going to do a whole lot of samples all at once. And I'm very happy to be attached to both these projects. I'm very happy to say that both of them are great successes, and that means that hundreds or thousands of people are being tested each and every week for both of these projects.
Now, you do different types of testing for each project, though, don't you?
Absolutely. But it's really nice that, I guess that's what genotyping in the name is. So we're the human origins, which is, I hope, fairly self-explanatory. We're talking about origins of people. And genotyping. Genotyping is we look at different parts of your DNA, your genome, your genes, and we see what they say. And what we look at are little parts in everybody's DNA that are likely to change. Places where, the genome is a large book. We've read this book before, and we know where the good parts are. We're looking at sort of the Reader's Digest version.
Okay.
And so we look at those pages, and we find those little changes, and those are the breadcrumbs on a genetic trail that leads us to where you are today.
Why don't you tell us, our viewers, what is it that National Geographic is doing exactly?
Well, it's National Geographic and IBM.
And
they have partnered together really with, I would say, the most ambitious genetics project in probably the history of humanity.
And the aim of the project?
The aim of the project is that, surprise, we're all from Africa. We all originate from Africa. We all originate from Africa actually again and again and again throughout the history of our species. But us as humans, as modern humans, we all trace back to Africa deep into about over 100,000 years ago. But really within the last probably about 60,000 years ago or more recently, climate started to change. And our ancestors started to move on. Africa had been a really nice, it was the cradle of humanity, and it was time to, it was time to leave the home.
I want to stop and say, Africa's a big continent. Can you narrow the, from Africa at all, whereabouts in Africa?
Well, it was sort of central East Africa.
Okay.
Probably more equatorial than not. And so our ancestors, being able to establish themselves in that part of the world, about that time that I'm talking about, there was a big ice age, climate change. And it seems like the equator would be a great place to spend an ice age. It's getting cold everywhere else. But you know what? During an ice age, there's a lot of ice, which means there's less free water, which that can also become a very hot, dry place. So then it's time to move on. And it isn't one of these things where, somebody rounds up the tribe and says, let's go. It's one of these processes that happens over thousands, tens of thousands of years.
And so the National Geographic IBM project is going, we started in Africa. Then what's it going to show?
Well, that's where it gets interesting, because what I can tell everyone watching today is that, surprise, we're all from Africa.
Okay.
But beyond that point, there are a lot of different routes to go. Okay. Everybody's ancestors moved on at different times and took different paths out of Africa.
Okay.
And so that is your deep time. And actually, as we were getting back to the different projects of my lab, I certainly don't want to leave out the work we do with Family Tree DNA.
Okay.
And so Family Tree DNA, that project actually, I feel, dovetails really elegantly with the work we do with National Geographic. We do both projects together with Family Tree.
And how does it dovetail?
Well, because what the Genographic project tells you about is your ancestry from really the beginning
until
to roughly about 1,000 years ago, I would say. So it's your ancestors from Africa to where they settled about 1,000 years ago.
Oh.
And then where Family Tree kicks in. I mean, within the last 1,000 years, that's something we consider more genealogical time.
Okay, so now I have a question for you. Now I'm beginning to understand some value. My maiden name was Amder. My Amder male cousins have done this. We have a DNA family project, and we are something called J2s.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that.
As am I.
Ah. Yeah. So you're my cousin. Okay. So now, 1,000 years ago, our ancestors were in a certain part of the world. Is that what that's telling us?
Oh, yes.
And where were they?
I mean, as a J2, what the Genographic Project and studies like this have shown me is
what?
That my ancestors started in Africa with everyone else's.
Right.
Then they moved on to the Middle East, where they settled down probably about 40,000 years ago. And they hunkered down in what's called the Fertile Crescent. I'm proud to say that, and this is my Y chromosome ancestors, I should say, were associated with one of the first populations to derive agriculture,
okay.
You know, inventive sorts.
So tell us, for those who aren't so good in geography, the Fertile Crescent was?
The Fertile Crescent is part of what we would now call the Middle East.
Okay.
But then they also, you find mostly J2s all around the Mediterranean.
Oh, yes, exactly.
North
I'm only at 40,000 years ago.
Okay. All right, go on.
So they hunkered down there. They, you know, spent some time. They figured out some great stuff, agriculture and all that. And then they sort of, some went the high road and some went the low road. And those roads lead us across North Africa and across the Mediterranean. And that brings us around that Mediterranean distribution. You find J2s. You find J2s in Italy, in the Mediterranean. You find J2s in North Africa. You find J2s in the Middle East. J2 is a very common marker in, or genotype, or Y chromosome flavor, even, we'll say, that you find in Jewish populations throughout the world. You also find it in Arab and other Middle Eastern populations at very high frequencies.
So
didn't I hear that the Jews are more closely related to the Arab population than they are to their neighbors wherever they might live?
Yes, actually, that was some work that came out of our research team. When I say our research team, I should explain also that the Human Origins Genotyping Laboratory were an outgrowth of Dr. Michael Hammer's laboratory. I've been working with Michael since 1993. It's been a while. And we have worked together on a lot of his projects that focus on Jewish ancestry, Jewish population genetics. I mean, actually, if you want to think about this whole field of genetic genealogy, the first genetic genealogical project we ever did was our study on the Kohanim.
Yes.
But what about the other whole set of Kohanim? That becomes a different question.
The Kohanim project, I will say we have found out a lot, and we're not done looking at it yet. There's still some current work to be done on that.
So when Mike Hammer started his work, people were using DNA mostly for forensics?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, and when Mike Hammer started his work, the idea of using the Y chromosome as a tool had been technologically impossible. I mean, where we saw in the late 80s, we saw mitochondrial Eve. We saw the first mitochondrial papers, and mitochondria is the part that we use to trace female lines.
Right.
And why did that work come out? That work came out because, quite honestly, you could get placentas. And bizarre as that may sound, but placenta is, you know, it's hard for a biologist who's studying humans to get a big hunk of tissue. Like, I can't come up to you and say, hey,
please
get a piece of your liver,
or
maybe your pinky or something like that. That's not going to work out. So this was before the technology that we use today, commonly called PCR. Well, PCR is an amplification process. So we can start with tiny amounts of DNA and make copies of them so we can study things that you can't get that much DNA in one place at one time. Where the placentas come in is that they're all going to have mitochondrial DNA, And it is a big piece of tissue, and so you could start to harvest big pieces of tissue and isolate just the mitochondrial DNA, and then you could start to analyze it. And that was work done actually in the lab where Mike Hammer was doing his doctoral work back at Berkeley.
Okay, because, you know, I'm just thinking about all that they've done so quickly.
Oh, yeah.
It's incredible. It boggles the mind. I've read everything I can.
Well,
on it.
But there's this man at the University of Haifa who works with Hammer also. His name is Bihar, and he does safari.
Oh, Bihar. Drone. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And he calls himself an anthropological geneticist.
Absolutely.
And so we've learned that there were, you know, these people went up into Europe, and then they married local women and all this.
Oh,
you can get a really phenomenal migration study from doing DNA.
Yeah. I mean, this is what we would call anthropological genetics, what we would call population genetics. I mean, these are all fields of genetics that look at diversity in populations.
Where do you see the DNA as the head of this, you know, you do the big projects. You're doing the National Geographic one and this new Shoah Foundation one. If you try to project ahead 10 years, where do you think the DNA is going?
You know, 10 years, you know, it's funny.
It's next year.
next year. You know, this is a field that's been very exciting. Because when I started doing this work in the 90s, you know, I used to be able to see 5 years down the road.
Yeah.
And then as we got closer to now, I was like, well, at least I can still see 3 years down the road.
Well, I remember when they first said it'll take many, many, many years to analyze. And all of a sudden they come out, it's all been, you know,
In 2000, we were giving my camera samples by taking scope and swishing it around and spinning into a test tube.
I was the one in the lab
who got
handling those samples, you know, with my own two hands.
But now we just take a Q-tip and rub the inside of our cheek.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's actually better if you use a real diagnostic swab.
Well, that's sent to you in a little kit.
As I know at least Family Tree sends out, and Genographic as well. I mean, this is a situation where those were projects that at that time we were doing, you know, 1,000, maybe 2,000 samples a year. That was pushing hard.
And now
we do 1,000 or 2,000 samples a week.
Okay.
If we don't do 1,000 or two, I start to sweat. Sometimes it's 4,000. Yeah.
Okay. Now, I'm trying to keep this clear in my mind. Yeah. The University of Arizona has a research lab.
Yes.
And you have a relationship with Family Tree DNA, which
yes.
is, what's the relationship between Family Tree DNA and the lab at the University of Arizona?
Well, Family Tree DNA, I should credit all of this to Bennett Greenspan.
Okay.
Because it was back in 99 and 2000 when Bennett had become familiar with our work on the Kohanim, and he said, well, that's a Y chromosome story. Is there anything special about that Y chromosome? And the answer is no. I mean, we trace Y chromosome lineages. That's what our lab had become real experts in. I mean, that's what Mike Hammer has been, one of the founding fathers of the Y chromosome as a tool for reading back in time.
Okay.
And so Bennett came to us and he said, well, I want to have, he wanted to have his DNA tested.
Yes, I remember.
For his ancestry. And Hammer said, well, we don't do that for the public. Like, you know, we do research studies, there's informed consent, there are research designs, there's grants and all that. That's not how it works. We don't just test some Y chromosomes. And Bennett said, okay, well then where do I go? And Hammer said,
there is
no place. And Bennett went,
Bennett
changed all of our lives.
Bennett's story is that Mike said to him, why don't you start a business?
That's quite possible, but I still credit Bennett for this, because if Mike said it, it was probably in a sarcastic fashion.
Okay, well then, so when we sign up with Family Tree DNA and they send the material to the University of Arizona?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. We do. Well, I should say actually now Family Tree has a very nice and established lab of their own. What we do at the University of Arizona is we do, once again, it comes back to this high throughput.
Right.
We do the high throughput testing when you have, you know, a whole bunch of samples, you know, hundreds, thousands, that you want to run for these tests. That's what my group are experts in. And what Family Tree does, which gives them a great amount of flexibility, is they have this other very nice facility in Houston, and they're able to do all the things that honestly, like, you can be the jack of all trades and the master of none.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not what Family Tree wants to be. I mean, Family Tree DNA They have their lab that in Houston, which is able to be much more flexible and much more responsive to this sample needs this special thing.
Yes.
As opposed to, you know, for me, it's take thousands of samples and get them done and get them done right now.
So that if there was a question about whether what you came up with, or maybe it came out as a 6 and everybody else is a 7 or whatever it might be, they want to retest it, they could do an individual retest.
Oh, they can do the testing that we can do at the university, at Family Tree,
but
on a more sort of individualized, customized format. I mean, a lot of the questions that we, on the data that we produce, we rerun ourselves in Arizona, and that's fine too, but it is actually nice having these paired labs. Is one of the things that we can do, really, is that we can be independently verifying each other's work.
Okay, here's my other question. Now there are other people who are doing DNA, and when I spoke to Bennett Greenspan, he said, you know, we've done so much Jewish genetic testing for genealogists that he claims that he feels that his database accurately represents the world of the European Jew, the Ashkenazic Jew.
Yeah, but what did he call it, a break-even point or something like that? That he
critical mass.
Critical mass.
No, critical mass.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So,
I mean,
from the point of view of the scientist, if a Jewish genealogist wants to do genetic testing and wants to find out who else might be related, is there value in going to Family Tree because they have a certain database that's rather specific and specialized, or will they get the same results if they go to some DNA testing group that's located in Utah or somewhere else?
Well, I mean, and I admit that I'm partial because I work with Family Tree DNA, but as a scientist, I mean, the way this part of science works, and this is true for the Genographic Project, this is true for the work we do with Family Tree, this will be true for the Shoah, is that it's all a comparative science. And what it comes out to be is that you have these databases.
Right.
And so being able to compare your sample to a database of other people that have been tested for the same parts of your genome.
Yes.
That's the magic of this all. And so when I look at this now, I mean, when we started doing this in 2000, you know, Bennett and I, we thought this would always be a service for, well, I know this guy, and we think we may be long-lost relatives. And so we're going to throw our DNA into the hopper, and we're going to see if we match.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it wasn't until the database got to about 10,000, I think it was, where we started to get what we would call sort of the cold hit, where we'd have people who just threw their DNA in because they're saying, well, I want to find out something about me.
Like Sonia Broza.
Yeah.
This is a story that we had on the show you're part of that group, so-called birth group.
Yes, absolutely.
That to me is still the most fascinating find of all of them. Well, and she just did it because she didn't know where else to go.
That ability to do that, so that was when the database was 10,000. Well, guess what? It's over 10 times that size now.
Really?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, everyone should know that they can go to Family Tree's homepage, familytreedna.com, and they can see what it is up to the minute.
Well, basically, yes. Right now, I must say that we have so many hits on this AMDR. Bennett organizes projects for specific family names. If you want to do, and aside from the fact that somebody like a woman from Puerto Rico getting her father's DNA and throwing it in the hopper and finding out that his ancestry wasn't a black genome, as he thought, was a J2, and that they're 100% match with your Worth ancestry.
Yeah.
I found another use for this. I mean, there are a lot of genealogical uses. We put up this AMDR thing. I've got what I call the main trunk of the tree back to the middle 1700s.
Mm-hmm.
There are other people around the world with the same last name, and they want to know if they're related to our main trunk.
Well, actually, that's one of the really interesting things that Family Tree has been able to pride, and it's actually through a related collaboration with the University of Arizona, is Dr. Bruce Walsh, who is a theoretical population geneticist. And what that means is that Bruce is really good with math.
Hmm.
And what Bruce has been able to put together for Family Tree is, they call it the tip. And at this moment, I have to admit, I forget what tip. No, not the SNP.
That's a different one.
Yeah, that's a different one. But what the tip does is that it gives you actual time of relationship.
Yes, and so that phylogenetic.
So we've been able to take the mutation rates, the rates of change of all the different places in the genome that Family Tree looks at, and some really big math, and Bruce has actually published papers in peer-reviewed journals on how he came to this math, and it looks at not only all the markers that have changed, but also all the markers that have not changed. And when I say marker, I mean a section of your DNA that we're reading. You know, we read the same places for everybody. That's how we can compare them together. And with those data and this math, we're able to give people really good estimates about when they most likely share an ancestor.
Right. And the greater the number of markers, the closer the time.
Well, I mean, it's one of these things like flipping a coin. Now, if I flip a coin one time, I can never get 50-50 out of heads and tails. Mm-hmm. If I flip it three times, I can't get 50-50. Even if I flip it 10, you know, it might be 60-40, it might even be 70-30. If I flip that coin 100 times, it's going to be 50-50. And it's the same thing with looking at parts of the DNA. I mean, that is one of the things where we never knew what direction this would go. And at the beginning, when we started this all, we were looking at 12 places on the Y chromosome. Right. And now, I'm really happy to say that we look at 67. Yeah, 67 different spots on the Y chromosome.
If you look at 67 on the Y chromosome and you find an exact match on these 67s, how far back approximately would your common ancestry be?
Well, you know, that I can't really actually say, because my closest match is four steps off at 67.
Oh.
But, I mean, you're going to be looking at someone who is very few. I mean, I'm talking about, like, you can count on one hand number of generations away.
Yes.
67.
Yes.
Yeah.
That
is the resolution of this tool.
That's what's so fabulous.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what we're getting with these people who have done their AMDR genealogies. They have a tree. They want to know if their tree connects with my tree and about when.
Oh, yeah.
We know when the name was first adopted. So if people have this name, likely it was, you know, they all came from that same person.
What's driven us to 67 markers is that the genealogical community who does this DNA testing, they want to be able to rebuild their family tree with DNA.
But we've got a different thing with Sid, because he's in a group now. I think they have about 15 people. Every one of them has a different name. Everyone, you know, they all end up coming from Lithuanian area within 100 miles or so of each other. So they must have a common ancestor.
Oh, yeah.
But nobody can go back that far.
Well, but
we're all working on it.
That's the thing about Jewish populations and surnames, is that Jewish populations and surnames are not as tight as non-Jewish populations and surnames.
Well, that's why
non-Jewish populations, you have very few changes and they trace back pretty far. Mm-hmm. Jewish populations, names have changed at any number of historic events.
Right. Yeah. And, well, they didn't have names before
they
the end of the 18th century.
Exactly.
Well,
exactly.
That's why we know that his has to be before them.
And the same human being changed his name. My grandfather changed his name God knows how many times from Europe to this country. So you have a lot of that kind of stuff. 67.
Yeah.
67 out of 67, I think, would have to be probably within three generations.
Three or four.
You know, all probability. I mean, I guess that's one of the other things that I, as an academic researcher, am very happy that Family Tree and we have gone this way in the beginning, is that, you know, one of the things that when we started this, you know, and other groups started to produce this, they said, well, the other guys just tell me yes or no.
Yeah.
And you guys give me this number, and people don't like the number. Like, it's, you know, there's a little extra thinking, but you know what?
In the long,
we want to let you do that thinking, because, you know, as a scientist, I can't tell you yes or no. These are not yes or no questions.
Right,
I mean,
exactly.
People say, are we related? Well, you know what? I hate to say we're all related.
Yes, yeah. At a 95% probability.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. And you might be outside the...
Yeah, the yeah, but I mean, these are probabilities, and that's the way, I mean, at this point, the genealogist who does DNA testing is looking at data.
Okay, now that's an important thing. We're getting probabilities, but when the lawyers go into court and they say that guy in prison didn't do the rape because his DNA doesn't match, they're not doing probabilities, or they are doing probabilities?
They are doing probabilities, but the probabilities at that point become so negligible on either side. I mean, this is actually one of the major problems with forensic science, is that the numbers and the probabilities have gotten so large. I mean, we're talking about trillions of people. The one in trillions. Yeah. And guess what? That's more people than have ever lived and been on this planet in the entire history of the Earth.
So what they're really doing is 99.99999.
Exactly. So that's
why they can say it's accurate.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But the problem is that the average person, a non-scientist, doesn't ever get to interact with numbers of that scale. I mean, you start to think about things like our deficit. Guess what? Not that big by comparison to these math.
Yeah. Huh. So tell me the kind of person that goes into this. How did you get to be a DNA maven?
Well, I'm a biologist by training, and I've been interested in biology as long as I could remember. I mean, since I was a tiny child, you know, apparently, I mean, my parents tell me that, you know, other little children, when they were asked, what do you want to be? I want to be a policeman, I want to be a fireman. And I said, I want to be an entomologist or a herpetologist.
Was Mike Hammer's background biology? All the people who do this started out sort of in the biological sciences.
We've had some come over from physics and math, because population genetics is a science of big math, and mm-hmm. people who like to think about, you know, applied math, actually, there's a whole new field coming out right now. I mean, computer power is big, and math is big, and these are big math problems. I mean, the ability to actually create a tree of relationships is one of the most mathematically complex problems that there is.
Oh, yes.
I mean, when you start to build trees, I think it's when you get out to 50 different individuals, whether they're species or populations or whether they're actual, you know, individual people. I think when you get to 50 individuals, there are more possible bifurcating tree relationships than there are particles of matter in the known universe.
Oh, God.
You want to talk about big numbers. These are big numbers. And that's why some of the math people have gotten really interested in the type of work we do.
I'll bet.
We've just got a few seconds left. Is there anything that we haven't touched on that we should?
I'm just happy to say that, you know, these are part of a new day of DNA testing. I mean, DNA itself is not that old, but this is DNA for fun. This is DNA for learning new things about yourself, be it deep time or recent time ancestry, genealogy ancestry. These are all questions along the same line, and I'm happy to be a part of that.
Thank you very much for being on the show with us.
Well, thanks
today.
For having me.
This is fun.